record of life during the Ice Age. We're proud to partner with UCLA Institute of the Environment and Sustainability on this climate change series. IOES aspires to educate the next generation of environmental leaders and move science to action. This series was a true collaboration in efforts to expand our reach to the communities of LA with a mutual desire to creatively engage the public with informative events like tonight. I want to express my appreciation to IOES Director Peter Carevia, who unfortunately couldn't be here tonight, and his talented staff, including David Chalais, for co-organizing these events with us. We will be convening here every other Thursday over the next 2 months. And how many of you have your tickets for the next lectures? That's great. Glad to hear that. I also want to give a shout out to NHMLA staff who collaborated on planning the events. Sue O, Vice President for Education and Public Programs. Laurel Robinson, Senior Manager of Public Programs. And the staff here at the Tar Pits, which has welcomed us all with open arms. Let's keep moving. So it is only fitting that we are holding this climate change series at La Brea Tar Pits and Museum. The Tar Pits, as I think most of you also know this, is an unparalleled scientific wonder. It's an active urban field site where an immersion into prehistoric LA helps us understand our world now and in the future. It really is a one-of-a-kind place. The Tar Pits presents the best opportunity anywhere in the world to understand how ecosystems respond to processes of biotic and climate change over timescales relevant to our current environmental situation. So let's talk a little bit about climate change. Surveys from the Yale Program on Climate Change Communication tell us that more than 60% of Americans are both interested in the issue of global warming and consider it personally important. However, only 31% of Americans report that they regularly discuss climate change with their friends and family, and that number has been dropping over the decades. So why do we think this is important? Well, this phenomenon is called by researchers climate silence. And the researchers say this is a bad development because if we're not talking about something, we're a lot less likely to work together to fix or adapt to the problem. And one of the reasons for climate science, these researchers say, is because many of us lack confidence in talking about what's going on. How do we get the language to talk about it? Thus, the purpose of this four-part series, starting with tonight, is to help you understand climate change better and also to feel more confident in talking about it with others. We need to close the gap a little between experts and all of us. Tonight's conversation, Climate Change Cliff Notes, is designed to give you a basic grounding in the science of climate change major impacts, and some of the most prominent solutions. All in 90 minutes, so pay attention. But I think you're gonna be able to pay attention because instead of boring lectures and a little bit of Q&A, we've come up with a novel format that's gonna be driven by all of you in the audience. To explain how that's going to work, I'm gonna turn over to our moderator, Bob Lalish, who runs the consulting firm Science and Story, and was for many years the Director of Science Communications at the Nature Conservancy. Thank you, Bob.
Thanks, Laurie. Good evening, everybody. So welcome to Climate Change Cliff Notes. We took two concepts, climate change and cliff notes, that usually send chills up everybody's spines when they hear them, and we mashed them together and said, boy, that's gonna be fun, right? Actually, it is gonna be fun, for two reasons. One, we have a world-class panel of climate scientists who I'm gonna introduce in a second, Sarah, Daniel, and Michael, who are going to tutor you and answer your questions about climate science. But the second component is you. This evening is not, as Laurie said, gonna be driven by presentations or panelists discussions, it's all about your questions. And we've come up with a novel, well, novel in my experience for climate discussions of how to conduct these questions. I'm going to take the microphone out of this and try to explain it to you. So, your questions, we've broken the evening into three parts. The first part's going to deal, the first 30 minutes are going to deal with science. Your questions about how do we know what we know about climate change? What don't we know yet about climate change? What are we uncertain about? What are scientists uncertain about? How do we know that it's anthropogenic and not just natural cycles? What do we know about what's happened in the past about climate? What's climate modeling all about? So that's the first 30 minutes. Then we're going to shift over to impacts. Impacts both locally, nationally, and globally. And we're going to cover all that in 30 minutes. Good luck. And then the final 30 minutes will be on solutions. How do we deal with the climate change that's already baked into the system? How do we adapt to that? How do we mitigate the climate change that we can control? So, how do you ask your questions? How are we going to respond to these questions? It's two parts. This is something, so climate change cliff notes is a new phrase. This is something also you're never going to hear at another event. We want you to pull out your phones and be on your phone for the entire 90 minutes. Your phone is going to be the way that you're going to interact with this session. You're going to submit your questions through the phone, and you're going to vote for the questions that you want the panel to answer through your phone. So go to the Wi-Fi network, IOES Public, and then launch your browser and go to pollev.com/IOES. And you'll be in the first poll. You'll see a number of questions there that people have been submitting already, and you'll get to vote on those questions, and those questions will pop up on the screen. There are some already that people have been voting on. You can vote a positive vote for a question. You can also vote a question down, right? So we're going to avoid passing out the microphone and having somebody say, I have three questions plus a statement. We've all been in events like that, right? So we're going to try to get through this pretty briefly. So 30 minutes. If you have problems with that, you can also log into the museum's Wi-Fi. If you have problems getting into the IOS public one, that doesn't require a password, but the plan B is to log into NHM-events, and the password there is climate change, all lowercase. Right. So we'll start, after the introductions, with some warm-up questions, and then we'll get right into your questions. Let me introduce our panel. Sitting to my left is Sarah Feekins. She's an associate professor of earth sciences at the University of Southern California. Sarah has over 15 years' experience conducting research on climate and ecosystems. Her recent work has tested the drought response of wheat crops and surveyed the diversity of tropical forest ecosystems, all in terms of the waxy coating on the surface of the leaf. She uses this knowledge of modern plants and the remarkable preservation of plant waxes to document changes in ecosystems over geological time. So I'm going to ask each of them one quick question. What's up with the waxy plants? Explain to us why that's so important for understanding climate change.
Well, your favorite houseplant is probably very waxy and shiny, but those waxes actually stick around for millions of years. So I can find those in ocean sediments. I can go back in time and reconstruct what plants were there.
Microphone's not on.
Think it'd be measured.
So your houseplants at home, they're very waxy and shiny. Some of our favorite houseplants are very glossy looking things. Those waxes, like the wax you might put on your lips on a hot, dry day like today, are there to protect the plant. And they're very resilient. They stick around for millions of years. So I can find them in ocean sediments and I can reconstruct past climates from that.
Thank you. Honored to be with you tonight. In the middle, Daniel Swain. Dr. Daniel Swain is a NatureNet postdoctoral fellow in UCLA's Institute of the Environment and Sustainability. As a climate scientist, Daniel studies the changing character and causes of extreme meteorological events and regional climate extremes, including atmospheric phenomena such as the, quote, ridiculously resilient ridge that are responsible for the droughts and floods in California. He also authors the Weather West blog, which he's done since 2006, which provides real-time perspectives on California and Western Northern American weather, climate, and regional change. So the question for you, Daniel, is what is the ridiculously resilient ridge and why should we care about it?
Well, so the triple R, for short, is the essentially the nickname that I gave to the persistent region of atmospheric high pressure that caused California's drought in the previous several years. It was a term I coined on the Weather West blog, in fact. It's gotten a lot of mileage over the last few years in describing this seemingly malevolent atmospheric force off the coast of California that deflected that rainfall for season after season after season. And fortunately, it went away last winter in a big way. But it's just one example of the kinds of extremes that we like to know more about in a changing climate.
Thanks. Great to be with you, Daniel. And finally, to the far left, my far left is Michael Mann. Dr. Michael Mann is director of the Earth System Science Center at Penn State University, where he is also a distinguished professor in Penn State's College of Earth and Mineral Sciences. He's the author of more than 200 peer-reviewed and edited publications, as well as three books, Dire Predictions, Understanding Global Warming, The Hockey Stick and the Climate Wars, Dispatches from the Front Lines, and together with co-author Tom Tolles, The Madhouse Effect, How Climate Change Denial is Threatening Our Planet, Destroying Our Politics, and Driving Us Crazy. In 2012, the European Geosciences Union described his publication record as, quote, outstanding for a scientist of his relatively young age, unquote. And Michael, of course, was also a lead author for a highly cited chapter of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, Third Scientific Assessment Report, which was published in 2001, also a co-founder and contributor to the climatology blog Real Climate. So my question for you is, this book, The Madhouse Effect, you co-authored this with Tom Tolles, who's a political cartoonist. Tell us why you did that.
Well, this was more than a year ago. This was last August that we published, September that we published the book. And we didn't realize how prescient this book would actually be a year later, because it may, in fact, be the case that a book filled with cartoons about climate change might actually be a book that our president would consider reading. there is a certain license to talk about difficult topics. And climate change has become a very contentious topic. It's become a politicized topic. And when that happens, it's often difficult to talk about the matter in sort of straight up commentary. Satire, comedy, sort of provides you a side door. And sometimes, you know, we know from watching the Colbert show or other comedy shows today, that sometimes you can get away with talking about a difficult topic when it's framed in terms of satire and humor. And so that's the approach that we brought to talking, hopefully in a different way, about the issue of climate change.
Great. Delighted to be with you. So we're going to start with some rapid-fire questions. We're going to hold these for just a second. And Colin, can we switch over to the rapid-fire questions, please? So these will appear on your phone, and we want you to answer these really quickly. We're already counting down. How often do you have a conversation about climate change? Daily? At least weekly? At least monthly? Or it's been a while / never? We're going to wait for 15 seconds and let everybody respond. Moving back and forth. Okay, and it looks like at least weekly is the winner here, but that squares up with what Lori was talking about climate silence. About half of people who think that climate change is important, and I think everybody who's here, it's a good indication you think climate change is at least somewhat important, half of those people don't talk at least weekly about climate change with friends and family. 22% daily. Interesting. Okay, let's go to the next one. Which best describes your view of climate change? Just wanted to get the temperature of the crowd. A, it's happening and human activity is driving it. B, it's happening but we're not clear on what's driving it. C, it's happening but it's part of natural historical fluctuations in Earth's temperature. And D, it's not happening. And we're done, so I think we have a consensus.
I think we have a biased sample.
We have, yeah, self-selection at work, right? Okay, the next one, Colin. Which best describes your political leaning? And these are not going to be saved. Republican, Democrat, Socialist, Libertarian, Anarchist, or other. And the anarchists should come up afterwards and talk to us about their solutions for climate change. I'm almost done. So, 10% of us are Republicans, 62% Democrats, 7 Socialists, 5 Libertarians, 3 Anarchists, 14 identifying as other. Final rapid fire is a word cloud. We want you to give us one word, type in one word that describes how you feel when you're talking to someone about climate change. We'll give you about 30 seconds to type those in. And the more people type in a word, the bigger it'll be. A lot of frustration, anxiety, some passion. Frustrated is also in there, too.
Some other words we can't.
And some other. Colin, my wonderful colleague from UCLA, will be moderating these questions, but he won't be able to moderate the word cloud, obviously. So, okay, so this part of the discussion, this first part, science. When I see a question that's not about science, but it's about impacts, we'll ask it. Obviously, you know, you guys are driving the bus, but we will try to reframe it in terms of the science to get a response that gets at that. So let's start with the first one. How best can we get beyond the skepticism about the science? And let's just get brief answers from all of you to start out with. Michael, starting with you.
Sure. Well, I think, first of all, we have to embrace the term skepticism. Skepticism is a good thing in science. It's what Carl Sagan referred to as the self-correcting machinery that keeps science on a path towards a greater understanding of the natural world. So we have to sort of reclaim the term skeptic and skepticism for its rightful role in the discussion. And distinguish that from contrarianism, or in its most profound form, a denial, outright denial of established science. There is, and this is something that I'm sure will come up further in the discussion, there has been an effort by some vested interests to sort of pollute the public discourse over climate change. And that means that a lot of those folks who are out there who express want to call it skepticism or contrarianism about science, are really sort of victims of a disinformation campaign. And there's a lot that we can do to help them out. I'm very much an adherent to the view that you can provide facts, you can provide figures, but what you really want to provide are resources that people can go back to. One of my favorite resources is a website called skepticalscience.com. You can download this thing as an app on your iPhone, and it's got the 100 or so leading climate change contrarian talking points and the responses to each of those talking points at the beginner, intermediate, and advanced level. So, if that's that Thanksgiving dinner with that uncle, we all have that uncle who comes armed with the various talking points. You say, well, Uncle Joe, that's actually number 3 on the skeptical science list, and the science actually says so and so.
All right, Daniel.
Well, I think I would just first reiterate what Mike just said about reclaiming the idea of skepticism in science. Scientists are, for the most part, skeptics by nature. It's literally in your job description to require evidence before you change how you think about something, or to actually change your viewpoint when presented with new evidence that's contrary to the views you once held. That's a fundamentally scientific approach to thinking about the world. And so skepticism in general is not a bad thing at all. Skepticism about the science is a little bit harder to approach. And I think, you know, one of the strategies that's been used over the years is to throw facts at people, to hit people over the head with the overwhelming consensus and the overwhelming scientific factual evidence that humans are warming the world and that's going to cause problems. But I think, you know, in an audience that is skeptical, either for genuinely held beliefs or for any other reason, you need a point of entry into that conversation. And so in my experience, one of the useful ways of sort of making that approach is to engage with a topic that's sort of peripheral to climate change itself, but is a good conversation piece. And my background is really more in meteorology, more in weather than in climate. And so I actually think about climate change sort of from the meteorologist's perspective, almost from a weather forecasting perspective. And so it turns out that that's often a convenient point of entry into the conversation with the skeptical audience, where I can literally talk about the weather, and then as it turns out, the kinds of weather we're experiencing is changing as a result of the fact that the climate is changing, and in fact, climate is nothing other than weather in aggregate. And so taking that approach with finding some commonality and some shared ground that isn't directly climate itself, but is climate adjacent, can be one way to approach a skeptical audience in that way.
Okay, so we can get to another question quickly. Sarah, skeptic comes up to you and says, I'm really skeptical. What do you tell them?
Well, that's probably me in this room, right? I mean,
nobody in this room, right?
Haven't had that yet this evening. Well, I think it's about having a conversation. So I'm, you know, ready to help people learn. I mean, I'm a teacher, I'm a professor. That's what I do. And so it's finding out what they think they know and helping them to know a little bit more.
Okay. So let's see the next one that's up. How can we credibly rule? No. I'm going to hold off on the drawdown one just for right now. We're going to go to the, how can we credibly rule out that the Earth isn't just going through another warming phase? Sarah, why don't you take that one?
Sure. So I study past climate, and it's true that we've seen lots and lots of variability in the past. Quiet, flat, boring times exist, but they're always disrupted, and sometimes very dramatically. But it's precisely that, studying what changed in the past and seeing what's changing today and seeing how fast it's changing, and then looking at knowing what forces those changes, seeing what pushes the climate system, and seeing that the only answer can be the greenhouse gases that we're putting into the atmosphere that are causing the warming. And it's unfortunately faster. The rate of change is faster than many of the most extreme things that we've seen in the past.
Okay, next question. So let's go to this drawdown question. We need to explain what drawdown is, first of all, which outlines substantive and accessible solutions to climate change. Daniel, what do you think of drawdown? Can you explain what it is briefly and then talk about your thoughts about it?
Well, so, you know, it's actually interesting. The three of us were just before this presentation got going, we're talking about this. And none of the three of us, it's a book that none of us have read. So the remaining answer, take it as you will from somebody who's never read the book. But I think the idea is it presents a list of a specific list of large-scale things that have to happen for drawdown to occur, where drawdown is essentially the net zero carbon emission society, where we're no longer producing greenhouse gases that cause global warming. So it sounds like it's a one approach to to getting there, to that point where we're no longer emitting carbon as a result of our daily life. But there's a specific list there, and I'm not really prepared to talk about the specific items on that list, except to say that the changes that are going to have to occur to get to that point of true carbon drawdown are huge. They're systematic, large-scale, transformational changes in almost every aspect of society, and there are a lot of ways to get there. And I think the challenge is going to be we need to figure out sort of what the optimal approach is. And I don't think we currently, it's not clear that there is a universally optimal approach. So
it ranks solutions, right? It ranks them in terms of efficacy. So
right.
It says curbing deforestation is number 5 and reducing food waste is number 12. And it basically ranks those in efficacy. And you're saying there's too much variability and
essentially, what I would say is that all of those things are really important, and we pretty much have to be doing all of them. It's just not totally clear that one is better than the other. It's really an all of the above kind of situation.
Okay, great. Next question. How good are climate models now, and why do they still disagree so much? So that's two parts. Who wants to take either one of those parts? Michael, you want to go?
Sure, I'll take the first part. How good are climate models? Well, when I got into the business of climate change back in the early 1990s, the models were not very good. If you looked at a climate model, first of all, it wouldn't produce an El Nino event. Now, you folks are mostly, if not all, Californians, and you know how important El Nino is. And if you want to understand how climate is going to change in California, you need to know something about how the El Nino phenomenon is going to change. So a model that can't produce an El Nino event isn't very helpful. Well, you can't stick El Nino into a climate model. It doesn't work that way. What you have to do is to get the physics of the atmosphere right. And you have to get the physics of the ocean right. And you have to get them talking to each other just right. And if you do everything right, then it will emerge. It's what we call an emergent phenomenon. Just like weather happens in a numerical weather forecasting model, El Nino will happen in a model that is adequate to capture the richness of the variability of the ocean and the atmosphere and how they interact in the Pacific and how that influences the rest of the world, including California. What I can tell you now is that you could put side by side observations of climate and a climate model simulation, the results of a high resolution climate model, a state-of-the-art climate model. And I might be hard-pressed to tell you which is which. The models now produce such a rich range of behavior, including very faithful-looking El Nino events, that it's actually hard to tell a high-resolution climate model apart from the actual observations. And the models have passed all sorts of important tests. Even the crude models that were around back in the late 1980s accurately predicted the amount of warming that we would see within some uncertainty range. The amount of warming we would see if we continued on the course that it turns out we have remained on in terms of our burning of fossil fuels and the elevation of greenhouse gases. So the climate models have come a long way, and there's reason to take them very seriously. Just like there was reason to take very seriously the numerical weather forecasting models that predicted that these recent tropical disturbances, Harvey, Irma, and Maria had the potential to become major Category 4, Category 5 monster storms. The models predicted that. We should be taking the predictions of climate models similarly seriously.
So I think the second part of the question, why do they still disagree so much, is about the future, right? Why is there so much variability in what they are saying is gonna happen 50, 100 years from now? So Sarah? Thoughts about that?
Yeah, I do have some thoughts. So the first thing I think always is good to focus on the positives and what do models do really well? And models do a really good job of predicting temperature rise. And we understand that physics really well, and models do a good job of predicting warming, and they agree on that Now, there are some things that models disagree on, and that, and one of those is things that we really care about. So here in California, yes, we care about the temperature, right? You care if it's such a hot day that you want to be in an air-conditioned building. But the thing that's been, we've been fretting over here has been whether it's going to rain or not, whether we're going to have water to fill our reservoirs to carry us through the dry season. And this year has been good, but the prior years were not. And going forward, what's water going to look like in California? Well, models don't agree on that. And we look around the world, and there are lots of places that have water problems like California, and we don't know if they're going to get wetter or drier. The models don't do a good job on that. And there's some really good reasons for that, and some that Daniel could probably speak to better than me. But we have to, you know, we have to deal with these things, and there are certain things in the climate system that are hard to model. A model is something that ticks boxes. You could make a toy box, right? You could put white paper on the bottom, you could put black paper on the bottom, you could put it out in the sun, and you could see that one would warm up more than the other. We can make simple boxes and we can make them more complex. And some things in science, some things in the atmosphere are hard. And one of those things that's really hard to get right is rainfall. So clouds, they're beautiful in the sky, and they happen, the droplets are on tiny, tiny scales, and the world is big. So we have a really big problem of scale and getting rainfall right. And temperature, by comparison, is very simple, and that's why the models agree very well on temperature, but they don't do a good job on precipitation.
Okay, we're gonna move on. It's a rich topic, we're running out of time for this section. So, top question, what do the fossils from the tar pits tell us about past climate changes? Especially the plants. I think, Sarah, you can answer this one. You can take this one as well and start out with.
Well, we have some pretty charismatic skeletons all around you. We've got bison and mammoth and saber-toothed cats. And these mammals were roaming this continent during the last ice age. So there was an ice sheet over Canada. The climate around here was fairly similar, maybe a little bit wetter. It had some variability in it. And at the end of the last ice age, almost all of these large animals went extinct. And there was a huge climate change, but there was also another thing that happened. And humans migrated over the land bridge from Siberia to Alaska, and they came down. And so the question is, was it early humans that killed off these megafauna, or was it the dramatic climate changes? And as with most things, it's not black or white, one or the other, but actually complexity, multiple factors, and maybe it was the two things acting together. And right now, we're in a situation where we have a lot of species at risk of extinction. We're changing the landscape, we're urbanizing, we're putting roads through, we're fragmenting habitats, and the climate is changing, and species don't have the space to migrate. This is a really big problem, and this museum really brings that to life.
Great. So we have time for one more question in this section. Give us three reasons why scientists, this will be a good wrap up, give us three reasons why scientists say climate change is being driven by human activity, not natural cycles or activities. Let's just go down the line, start with Michael. Give us one reason apiece why it's definitely anthropogenic, not a sunspot or something else.
So if you take the climate models and you drive them just with the predominant natural factors, variations in solar activity, solar output, and volcanic eruptions, the climate should have actually cooled slightly over the past half century, rather than accelerating in warming. It turns out that when people ask what percentage of the warming of the globe are we responsible for, and we've heard politicians say things like, well, you know, we might be responsible for some of the warming. You know, humans might have some role. And this is a popular refrain among sort of contrarian politicians who don't really want to embrace this as an existential threat. And they'll say something like that. And the reality is that we are responsible for more than 100% of the warming of the globe, because natural factors most likely were gently pushing us slightly in the other direction over the past half century.
Daniel?
Reason number two, if we look at the character of the warming that has occurred so far on Earth, the structure in the vertical sense in the atmosphere and the horizontal sense across continents and oceans, it's that pattern of warming that we're actually observing in the real world is exactly the pattern of warming that would match warming if it were due to an increased efficiency of the greenhouse gas effect, which is in fact exactly what we would expect to occur if humans were the cause of global warming.
And Sarah, number three.
Yeah, so scientists measure things, and we know how much fossil fuel we're taking out of the ground, and we can also measure how much CO2, the product of combustion, is rising in the atmosphere. And we can put two and two together and see that's what caused it.
Great. Okay, so that closes out the science portion. We're going to move to the impacts portion. And on your phone is going to appear, are going to appear three maps. The first is a map of the LA Basin. And we'd like you to just touch it and indicate where you live. And we'll give you a little time to do that. Can you guys see this? And while we're doing that, I want Sarah and Daniel, Michael can jump in as well, to talk about what are we seeing right now in this area? What are the impacts from climate change that we can see right now? And what are we going to be seeing by 2050 or 2060 that we need to think about? And if you want to pinpoint places on the map where there's some variability, let's do that. Sarah, let's start with you.
So you might have noticed that it was a pretty hot day today. It was in the 80s. It was dry. There was quite a lot of pollution in the air. Sort of gentle winds were blowing the pollution from inland out. And to me, that always feels like the apocalypse of the future is upon us, sometimes more than other days. So I can sort of imagine the future very easily. We live in a hot, dry desert. And the further inland you go, the more you realize that. If you're fortunate enough to live closer to the ocean, you get the cooling breeze off the ocean almost every day of the year, except for a day like today. And that keeps it cool. So closer to the coast, you don't need air conditioning currently, but inland, you certainly do. And as the planet will warm up, so too will the LA Basin. We have very little protection in the sky. We have very little sunshade. We have very few clouds that reflect the sun. So as we warm the atmosphere by adding greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, the LA Basin is going to warm, and it's going to be really unpleasantly hot, especially inland. And if we live in an air-conditioned box, you know, like this nice cool museum, then we're okay. But if the power goes out, we notice that it's a hot day, or if we take a walk outside.
Okay. Daniel, thoughts about what we're seeing here and also interactions with the state in general?
Yeah, well, one of the interesting patterns actually on the map that I see is there's a lot of folks from the west side of LA, and then there's also a fair number of people from the San Fernando Valley inland. And, you know, the separation, even though it can take a little while to get there on the 405, the geographic separation is really not that far. There's this range of really low coastal hills, essentially, that separate them, and yet the climate of these two regions, the west side of LA and the inland valleys of LA, can be really profoundly different. On a hot day in July, it can be easily be 105 degrees inland and 70 degrees on the beach in Santa Monica. And these really strong horizontal temperature differences when you're close to the California coast are sort of part of the intrinsic climate here. I think really anybody who's lived here for more than a few years is acutely aware of that. And that kind of pattern is something that we'll probably still have several decades from now where it will still be much warmer inland than at the coast. So some things will remain familiar, but you know, as everything shifts towards warmer conditions, as Sarah mentioned, you know, the temperatures in those inland areas in summer are often going to be dramatically warmer than they have been. And we've seen preview of that to a certain extent over the last couple of years, although it's actually been worse in other parts of California than in the LA Basin. But in the coast, along the coast in particular, where you still have this fog layer much of the time that sort of exerts this moderating effect on temperature, you still get these occasional excursions towards much warmer temperatures, especially this time of year when you have these offshore Santa Ana winds. And we saw a really dramatic example of this recently, not in the LA basin, but actually in San Francisco, where it hit 106 degrees right near the water in downtown last month, which was the hottest temperature observed there in recorded history, which goes back about 150 years. So these really extreme temperatures in places where we're not used to it are going to cause problems. And as Sarah mentioned, if you're sitting in an air-conditioned box, that's not so much of a problem. But if you're a tree in the forest, or you're a human living in a fourth-floor apartment without air conditioning, that's going to have a profound influence in your day-to-day life.
So we've got 30 seconds left in this. Michael, any thoughts about resilience across this map? What makes a community, so heat's gonna obviously be a huge problem going forward. What makes a community more resilient or less resilient to those kinds of extreme temperatures?
Well, I mean, there are adaptive measures that you can take, and that has to do with, as temperatures literally get too warm for humans to be exposed to, obviously we're spending more time inside and we rely upon reliable air conditioning. Agriculture, when you talk about resilience writ large, of course, the real issue here is what happens to the climate of California influences agriculture in California, influences livelihoods in California. And there is some uncertainty. We've talked about some of the reasons for that. What happens to the El Nino phenomenon is going to have an impact on the ridging pattern that Daniel has described. What sort of winters do we get, wet winters or dry winters in the future? And the models don't quite agree on that, in part because they don't necessarily all agree on what will happen to the El Nino phenomenon. So there's some debate about whether California, Southern California, will get more rainfall or less rainfall in the future. The evidence, in my view, seems to be now weighing in towards California getting less rainfall, and in part just because the subtropics tend to expand, that high pressure region tends to expand polar, most likely less rainfall. But even if California weren't to get less rainfall, there will be warmer soils, warmer temperatures, more loss of moisture to the atmosphere, less snowpack, because less of what used to fall as snow will fall as snow in the winter, so you don't have that reservoir of water that's available as runoff in the spring. All of these factors together point towards worsened drought. And what made the recent drought so unusual wasn't just the lack of precipitation, it wasn't just the high temperatures, it wasn't just the low snowpack, it was all of these things coming together in a way that they just haven't come together. And when I say they just haven't, the paleo evidence suggests that the recent drought was the worst in at least 1,200 years. And people sometimes say, well, 1,200 years, okay, so what made it happen 1,200 years ago? I mean, there weren't any SUVs around then, right? No, at least 1,200 years. The paleo scientists can't go back any further with the data that they have. Worst drought in at least 1,200 years, probably not a coincidence.
Let's move to the second map. So have you lived anywhere else in the US? Touch that place, or if you haven't, how about a friend or family member? Let's just do that really quickly over the next 30 seconds. And if everybody has lived here in Southern California, just go ahead and touch Southern California, that's fine. So I want our panel to look at this map and we hear a lot about sea level rise. We hear a lot about what's going on the coasts. Let's pick a place that we don't always talk about and talk about that. Michael, let's start with you really quickly. Where would you pick a place that we don't always talk about that's going to get hit by climate impacts? And interesting. Yeah.
Well, we could talk every state. There are interesting attributes in how climate change is going to impact every single state in the union. I'm impressed, by the way. It seems that there's at least one person from central Pennsylvania, maybe another Penn Stater in the crowd. Go Lions. We hear a lot about Florida flooding, sea level rise, the Gulf Coast, the southeastern U.S., of course, hurricane impacts. But the Midwest, Kansas, you know, we don't talk that much about climate change in Kansas, but you know, as those subtropics continue to expand forward, what we think of as the belt of deserts moves into the southern United States, and not just the western U.S., but even the southeastern U.S. Becomes more prone to drought, and states like Kansas become more arid and hotter. And you know, we've seen a number of summers recently where you know there were triple digit high temperatures over large parts of Texas, Oklahoma, and Kansas over much of the summer. And at some point, those conditions just don't support agriculture. There's a certain temperature above which human beings basically can't exist. And some studies show that if we continue with business as usual, burning of fossil fuels, then the entire tropics basically becomes unlivable. And so then we're talking about other impacts. As the tropics become unlivable, then the extratropics becomes more attractive as a place to live. And we're dealing with the issue of environmental refugeeism. And with environmental refugeeism comes conflict. And we've seen that play out in recent years. In fact, now going somewhat far afield, but Syria has also had the worst drought as far back as the paleoclimate scientists can go. They tell us at least 900 years, the recent Syrian drought, worse than at least 900 years. There's a very credible argument that that drought played a part in the instability that forced rural farmers into the cities, Damascus, competing with those who already lived there for food and water and space. That led to conflict. It created an environment where terrorism can gain a foothold, and that's where ISIS gained a foothold.
Okay. Either one of you want to talk about any other point on the map? Alaska, for example, or?
I was looking at the Pacific Northwest.
Okay, go ahead.
There's a few up there.
Yeah.
And I want to take it offshore. And a student in my class last semester was from Portland, and she wanted to look at the problem of a drop in oxygen in the ocean. So as ocean waters warm up, they off-gas, just like a glass of something fizzy would, as it warms up, it would lose its gas to the atmosphere. And oxygen is a gas, and so it comes out of the water as well. So there's actually a deoxygenation of the water that happens, and that fish need oxygen, and so there are dead zones that are appearing. In some places, that's to do with pollution and pesticides and fertilizers that are fertilizing things in the water column, allowing algae to bloom. That happens down in the Gulf of Mexico, but in the Pacific Northwest, that's not so much the case. And so it actually seems to be temperature rise and lowering oxygen and a real problem for the crab and the salmon fisheries up there. And of course, the other problem with CO2 is not just temperature rise, but ocean acidification. And on the West Coast, we're pretty fond of our seafood, and that's going to impact livelihoods and obviously the ecosystems.
Great. Let's move to the final map, which is a world map. And where's the farthest a grandparent of yours grew up? Touch the map right now. So a bunch of Europeans. Looks like we've got a Colombian, I think. So let's start talking about this right now. Nobody from South Asia yet. Right now, but what we don't have is we've got a lot of Europeans. Not many people from the tropics. Not many people from desert areas. Daniel, what strikes you from the map, and what would you like to talk about?
Well, I see. As you mentioned, there's a lot of folks whose grandparents come from the extratropics, as we might say. So from these temperate mid-latitude regions, as opposed to the warm tropical zone. What's interesting is that we were talking earlier a little bit about the how climate models are uncertain, and it turns out that uncertainty in climate models and future projections, it varies a lot from region to region, and it turns out that in many cases it's the extratropics that are especially hard. certain regions within them in particular. And I guess what's interesting to me is that we, on both sides of the big ocean basins in the Northern Hemisphere, so the Pacific and the Atlantic, the ocean basins themselves are changing in very different ways between basins, but in profound ways nonetheless. And the ways that the oceans are changing in the Pacific, potentially affecting how El Nino evolves, for example, and in the Atlantic, the changes, the meltwater from Greenland, for example, or other changes in these large-scale ocean circulations associated with the Gulf Stream, for example. Both of these sorts of changes on the large scale in the oceans as the climate warms is potentially affecting storm tracks, so these prevailing regions where storms form and sort of angle themselves onto the continents. Usually they form over the oceans and then move over land. And most of the people on this map live in those regions that are potentially right in that zone where storm track changes could be really quite substantial, either leading to more storms and more precipitation in some cases, or in regions closer to the subtropics, as Mike mentioned, less precipitation and more drought. And so these are sort of global hotspots, actually, of some of these kinds of changes that we might be thinking about.
We also have a couple of people who, it looks like one person, a grandparent from Alaska, a couple from up in Russia, a couple near the Arctic Circle. I'm going to throw out the question, permafrost. How concerned should we be about the melting of the permafrost and how much carbon there is there? And we should explain what that is, first of all, in the 90 seconds we have. Who wants to take that? Sarah?
Sure. Permafrost means permanently frozen ground. And my godmother actually worked in the Arctic regions of northern Canada. And people have been very confident that global warming has been happening for a really long time because the effects of warming are amplified towards the poles. This has impact for houses. Houses are moving because they were built on solid ground before and now it's fluid. Coasts are eroding. And of course, things that people care about, maybe not those of you in this room, but oil flows and torques, apparently, and pipelines have to deal with the fact that the ground will be moving. So it's a big issue. And strange features are appearing on the landscape as the permafrost gives way and massive erosion is happening.
What about the permafrost as a carbon? It is a carbon sink right now, right?
It's storing a huge amount of carbon that's been built up for a long time. And as that thaws, it releases it and it can return to the atmosphere. And some of that can return in a sort of slow sense. Think of decomposing vegetable matter returning out to the atmosphere again, but sometimes it can burp out like methane from a cow.
Great, nice image. To move into the, talk about an impact. Okay, let's move to the questions. So these are questions that you weren't, this is a totally new section, all the questions from before are wiped out. We've seeded some questions in here. We've got one already. But we'd like you to, I'm gonna give you guys a minute to type in some new questions about impact, and that can be from anything from what's gonna happen here in LA, what's gonna happen globally, what's gonna happen in the United States. You can talk about water, food security, governance, climate migrants, impact. Ask your questions of the scientists and then vote on what's going on. Vote on the question that you would like us to ask. So let's start with this first one, which seems to be getting a number of votes right away. The effect on Santa Monica, Venice, Pacific Palisades, shorelines in the next 5, 10, 20 years. Somebody's got some property. Yeah, I was going to say that. And thank you for this series. That's not a question, but you're welcome. So the effect on the shorelines in the next 2 decades for those places.
Sure, I mean, as a local, Venice is particularly low-lying. There's a few beach towns that are particularly low-lying, right? Venice, Hermosa Beach, Huntington Beach. And so for much of California, the sea level rise is not as big of an issue because we have a lot of rocky coastlines, a lot of land that's above sea level, but for some of those low-lying communities, they are going to be affected by sea level rise, just like places in other parts of the country as well.
Yeah, I think one of the interesting things about sea level rise as an impact of global warming is that it's one of the impacts that is potentially, as big as it seems, vastly underestimated. And almost all of the uncertainties with regard to how much the oceans are going to rise fall on the upper end of that range of possibilities. So it's one of those cases where uncertainty is not our friend. With regard to sea level rise and the actual sea level rise, there's some recent evidence that what we end up seeing from any given degree of warming might be higher than we previously thought. And a lot of that comes from the fact that the polar ice sheets, the land ice on Antarctica and in Greenland, is potentially less stable than we used to think it was, and that more of that may melt more quickly than we previously thought. And so the range of sea level rise that we hear about often of 1 to 3 feet, you know, in this sort of century, there's a reasonable chance that it could be a fair bit more than that. And the regional impacts, as Sarah mentioned, depend a lot on the local topography and the local geography. And in some places, the difference between 1 foot and 6 feet really isn't that big if you're where there's a coastal cliff, for example. But if you're up in Northern California, for example, in the Bay Area, and all of your major airports and most of your major freeways are within 5 feet of sea level, there's a big difference between 1 and 6 feet of sea level rise, for example.
Okay, next question. Or let's take a look at the questions. How are climate change and 5 of 6 of the last extinction events linked? Michael.
Well, climate change is certainly involved in what's sometimes referred to as the 6th extinction event, which is the one that we're witnessing right now, where we know we are the cause. Now, climate change is only one contributing component of how we are causing this extinction. Land use, destruction of habitats and rainforests, overfishing, etc. So this most recent extinction event, we know that climate change is playing an important role. We also know that perhaps the most famous extinction event of all, the so-called KT boundary, the demise of the dinosaurs, which we now have good reason to believe was caused by a major impact event, an asteroid that ejected dust into the atmosphere, and that dust blocked out sunlight. It led to cooling, very dramatic cooling. It led to, obviously, major climate change. There are other extinction events where we know, for example, that the oceans went anoxic. As Sarah mentioned earlier, the lower the oxygen in the ocean, the less support there is for the metabolism that allows fish and other marine organisms to live. So I think there's increasing evidence that climate change, in some sense, played a role in just about every one of the last 6 major extinction events.
Okay, so not just 5 of 6, but
nailed
them all.
We'd have to go through them one by one.
Okay.
Yeah,
not enough time. Next question. At what point do world leaders acknowledge that we're already committed to blow past 2 degrees centigrade and start truly treating climate change as the existential emergency it is? E.g., price on carbon. This actually belongs in the solution section, but let's just take it now. Price on carbon, no more subsidies for fossil fuels, no more climate denial in Congress, comma. Okay, we get the picture. I'm not sure we can answer that question, but you want to take a, Daniel, you want to take a shot at it? What do they?
Sure, I think one answer to this is that that some world leaders are taking it that seriously today. And there is still a wide range in the degree to which the problem is really being addressed from country to country and even within countries. And even in the US, there's a huge difference between what's happening right now at the federal level and what's happening at the state and local level, especially here in California, for example. So that's one optimistic take on that, but I think it is important to acknowledge that even the kinds of efforts being undertaken by California and some of these very forward-thinking countries around the world is still not on the order that it needs to be to really solve the problem in the long run and actually get to net carbon zero sooner rather than later.
So let me turn that question around just a little bit and ask it in a different way. What would be a really dramatic climate change linked impact that you think would get world leaders' attention and be a tipping point for decision making? Sarah?
Sure, we've had a few big climate events in the news, right? We've had a few big hurricanes, and so these really big hurricanes do get people's attention, and they do start us talking about the weather and asking if the climate is changing. And this is a particularly bad hurricane year, right? And we've seen storms intensifying faster than before, lasting for longer at these very high intensities, and we understand that. We know that the ocean is warmer and that evaporates more water into the atmosphere. And that's what fuels the storm. It's not a mystery. We understand that a warm world can sustain these storms for longer, can intensify these storms. They can even take these storms to higher latitudes. We saw that even a storm that's weakened down can cause massive impact, right? The levees broke in New Orleans when the storm was a lot weaker, and that was devastating. Storms that travel up the East Coast, they lose their power as they go over colder water, but Hurricane Sandy caused a lot of devastation along the coast there. So it's not just the Category 5 and 4 storms that caused devastation, but obviously you saw the devastation was total. Every wall knocked over, every tree knocked over. And this does bring us a wake-up call, and if we ignore that, I mean, what can we do, right? This is not something we can ignore. But you can see how much coverage it gets, because we do get fatigued. Hurricane Harvey caught our attention in Irma. But then there was a problem that Puerto Rico didn't really get the coverage that it needed. But the problem was really severe, and we start to lose focus, and we focus on other things, things that are important, but maybe not existential crises.
And by this, the question implies world leaders, meaning I think political leaders, but there are a lot of corporate leaders, for example, who are leading the way here and are already acknowledging it because it means a lot to their bottom lines. We need to move on to the final section. Past 8 o'clock, so we've rounded the bend. We're going to deal with solutions right now, both mitigation and adaptation, and we're going to cleanse the palate with a quick set of quiz questions for you, which I pulled out of the IPCC. We're gonna do these, right? So this, okay, quiz, which of these economic sectors produces the most greenhouse gases worldwide? Transportation, industry, electricity and heat production, ag, forestry and other use, land use, or building? Give you 20 seconds to respond. Ag, forestry in the lead right now. And this is worldwide, not the United States, but worldwide. Okay, time's up. We're going to freeze it. Our answers were 40% ag, forestry, and other use, 26% transportation, 22% electricity and heat production. Industry 10, buildings 3. Michael, I'm going to turn to you for the answer because I actually took it out of your summation of the IPCC report. What's the right answer?
Well, I can tell you that agriculture and forestry aren't nearly as aren't responsible for nearly as much emissions as people tend to think. This audience isn't unique in this regard. There was a movie, Cowspiracy. How many people here saw Cowspiracy? A fair number of people. Its heart was in the right place, but it did communicate some serious misinformation when it comes to the relative role of animal agriculture, and the eating of meat. Basically making it seem like our reliance on meat in our diets is the main contributor to global warming gases, and that simply isn't true. It's a much smaller fraction, maybe about 15%. The main contributors are power generation, which comes still mostly from the burning of fossil fuels, transportation, and then sort of everything else together makes up the sort of the lion's share of the remaining emissions.
Yeah, I think worldwide from 2014 it was electricity and heat production were slightly edging out transportation, although transportation in the US is slightly more.
Yeah.
Okay, next quiz question. Who is the top greenhouse gas emitter? Who was the top greenhouse gas emitters, pardon me, in 2014? Russia, EU, India, China, United States, everyone else. Everyone else, we're lumping everyone else in the world together in political entities. 5 seconds. And China, 65%, and that is the correct answer. Yeah. All right, one more question. Which of these solutions is not considered adaptation to climate change? And we'll talk about what adaptation is and is not. Buying out homeowners in flood-prone areas, installing lighter-colored roofs, seeding clouds to create rain, reducing poverty, installing coastal oyster reefs, or living car-free. Did we close out already? Can we open that back up for another? Colin can do anything. And now you've got another 15 seconds to respond. No one choosing the roofs option. And it warms my heart that coastal oyster reefs is hardly being chosen by anyone, and being a former employee of the Nature Conservancy. Okay, now we're done. 39% chose reducing poverty. Does anyone know what the right answer is on the panel? It's actually living car free. Living car free is a mitigation option, not an adaptation option. Anyone, Daniel, want to explain why? What's the difference between mitigation and adaptation?
Yeah, I think, and this is often something that's conflated. It's worth getting the difference straight. Climate mitigation is any action that causes a reduction in carbon emissions and reduces the actual amount of climate change that occurs. So either reduces or eliminates the increasing global mean temperature. Whereas a climate adaptation is something that we as a society do to cope with the effects of a given amount of global warming. And so I think the reason why then living car-free falls into the former rather than the latter bin is that living car-free ostensibly means you're reducing the amount of carbon that your lifestyle requires, and so you're potentially reducing the overall amount of warming.
I'm actually going to challenge
that was going to be my follow-up as well, yeah.
Because installing lighter colored roofs technically is a form of mitigation. It's an attempt to lower the so-called albedo of the surface, to increase the albedo of the reflectivity of the surface, so that the surface reflects more solar radiation back to space. So technically speaking, that would be a mitigation, although to the extent that it cools your home, it's an adaptation as well.
So before we move to the questions for this section, can somebody explain why reducing poverty is an adaptation? Falls under adaptation?
I think that was going to be my counterpoint, was that it definitely falls, I think, in both bins. Because if you reduce poverty, obviously you're reducing societal vulnerability to the impacts of extreme climate events and global warming. So that's clearly true from an adaptation perspective. From the mitigation perspective, you can imagine that there are certain inefficiencies that occur in parts of the world where there aren't the resources to do things in a way that is environmentally friendly, or in a way that minimizes the production of greenhouse gases, for example. And if you get placed everyone in a position where you can afford to mitigate, then more mitigation will occur.
All right. So we're going to blame the IPCC for the arbitrary definition. Let's move to the questions. Yes. Right. So again, we're starting from scratch. We've preloaded a couple of questions that you can vote on, but I'm going to give you about 45 seconds to start to enter your questions before we ask the first one, and also vote on these. And of course you can see, I hope, all the questions on your phone or tablet as you're following along, so you can vote on those. So let's start with this first one at the top. That's a good one. What are the three most effective things? This is a drawdown question, but I'll put you on the spot. Three most effective things individuals can do to combat climate change. We have three panelists. Let's take one at a time. Sarah.
Okay. Well, I think the big one for many of us in this room might be flying. So fly less.
Okay. And tell us why that's a science-based way to combat climate change. What's going on with flying?
Because flying uses fuel that contributes greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, and even just, you know, a single flight can be much more than the amount of, it would be better, for example, to take a train for an equivalent distance journey. It takes longer, but we, you know, if you have enough resources to fly, people are flying a lot these days. They're flying, and that's probably, for many people in this room, it might be their biggest footprint.
The climate offset from the airline. Put the question in the phone, and we'll vote it up. Daniel.
I would say vote and have conversations about how your elected leaders are addressing this problem or not. Yeah. And the reason why voting and being engaged with that process at that high level is important, as all the solutions really fundamentally are large scale solutions that are going to have to involve buy-in from people leading nations and leading states and towns and counties. So at all levels, that's really important.
Great, Michael.
I'm gonna cheat and go with voting again, because I think it's that important. There are personal actions, there are all sorts of individual actions that we can take to try to minimize our own carbon footprint. And in many cases, those are things that save us money, they make us healthier, they make us feel better, so we ought to be doing them anyways. And we should all be doing those things. But you know, you or I, none of us in here can institute a carbon tax. None of us in here can institute tradable emissions permits. We need to make sure that our policymakers are answerable to us, rather than the special interests who too often finance their campaigns and collect dividends in the form of policies that hurt us while helping special interests like the fossil fuel interests increase their profits and avoid regulation.
Great. Let's go back to the list and see what's popped up at the top. What other states or countries do better in regards to addressing climate change, and how should we follow their example? Who wants to take that?
I'd be happy to take a stab at this. So I wanted to actually return to the question that asked which was the biggest carbon emitter, and China is the correct answer, with the US behind. And recently people have asked me, you know, so in the Paris Accord, you know, the US was losing out here. And
So China is a very big emitter currently. It also has a bigger population. But if you think about, a lot of the CO2 emissions from China are actually manufacturing goods. The US is still a huge consumer, and we've essentially outsourced a lot of our pollution to China. So while we might say, okay, finally, we're not the worst culprit here, we've got to remember that we're looking better because we've shifted our manufacturing offshore, and of course that has consequences for American jobs too. So we can't just point the finger and say China's doing worse. And actually, one of my big sources of optimism is that none of us want to breathe dirty air. And I wasn't in LA in the 1970s when the air was more polluted, but we passed acts to clean up our air because none of us want to breathe that. And there is some hope that China, as it becomes more affluent, will want to clean up its air too, because it has really adverse human health impacts. You breathe in and you feel that immediately. And so I do have hope that they will transform really rapidly. And some of those health mitigation choices will also be positive in terms of reducing emissions.
Is there a shining example, another country or another state, Norway with funding for reforestation, or another country that you'd want to cite, either one of you?
I would say it's the rest of the world. We are falling behind the rest of the world right now. China is investing a lot more in renewable energy technology than we are. And in fact, they've flooded the global marketplace with cheap solar panels, which has actually helped lower carbon emissions globally. Europe, the European countries, just about every country, every other industrial country right now is embracing the great energy revolution of this century, which is the renewable energy revolution. And yet here, with the recent change in political winds, we're now moving in the wrong direction. We're now doubling down on fossil fuels and on the dying industry of coal, when the rest of the world is moving ahead with renewable energy. Those countries that move ahead now are going to be leading the world economically in the future, and we risk falling behind because we're not keeping up with the rest of the world.
Okay. Next, let's go back to the list. LA 2050, if we took climate change seriously, what would change in the city from today? Obviously, there are many plans in LA, civic plans right now, to address this, but Daniel, what would the city look like in 2050?
In a certain sense, I think it's going to have to look very different, partly because LA is a car city, and it's, you know, the existence of freeways and literally millions of cars is sort of ubiquitous in a way that it isn't almost anywhere else in the world. We already live in a nation of cars relative to the rest of the world, and even within that Los Angeles stands out. And so there's sort of, from a transportation perspective, then there's sort of two big questions. Is one, do we move away from personal automobiles in general? Is that something that happens? Or instead, do we keep the kinds of infrastructure that we currently have, but make this whole-scale transition towards truly electric vehicles running on a truly clean energy grid? And the reality is probably going to be somewhere in between, where it's hard to foresee Los Angeles without cars, and I don't think that's probably going to happen. But what I do think will happen, probably sooner rather than later, is that all of those cars are going to be electric cars running off of solar energy or wind energy or other sorts of renewables, and that in addition to that, there's going to be a lot more public transit, and there are subway systems in the works right now, and there's expansions, but there's still a long way to go. So I think in LA, because it's such a car-centric city, the future will look different just because cars and the way we interact with them will be so different.
Just a quick interjection here. Is it my imagination, or did we recently hear that Jerry Brown is considering the possibility of requiring California to move entirely away from gasoline-driven vehicles,
And at the personal level, I mean, I'm living like it's 2050 now, right? I mean, I believe that this is something that we need to change our behavior. And so, I mean, I take the bus to work every day. My husband rides an electric bicycle because he has a long commute up a big hill. And my son rides his bicycle to school. So we already are committed to not driving our cars around the city. And I think that our air quality on days like today and every day would be so much better. So we should all do it for other reasons. We should be transitioning now. We shouldn't be waiting for some mythical date in the future.
What do poor neighborhoods in LA look like if we take climate change seriously? Obviously, there's been a lot of coverage of potential conflict between the cap and trade, state plan, and offsets hurting poor neighborhoods, and that's been a concern in the environmental justice movement. What do poor neighborhoods look like when we take climate change seriously? What are the changes?
The air quality would be a lot better because, I mean, poor neighborhoods in general have lower air quality. They're right near a lot of the pollution sources. They're closer to freeways. They're closer to all of our refineries. So the less we are making those pollution sources produce, the better those neighborhoods will be. But yeah, we do need to make sure that, it's a huge issue in LA. We need to make sure that people can get to jobs, that they can move around the city, that the public transportation network connects, that people can move around.
Okay, let's go back to the list. Geoengineering, of all the solutions, which one is the most promising? Michael.
Well, in my view, there is only one truly efficacious geoengineering solution solve this problem. It's called a time machine. But we're not going to get that. Just about every other geoengineering scheme that has been proposed comes with the problem of potential unintended consequences. If we shoot particles into the stratosphere to try to block out some of the incoming sunlight, that could end up actually changing large-scale atmospheric circulation patterns. We could end up warming some regions even more. We could end up, we wouldn't be dealing with the accumulating CO2 in the atmosphere, so we wouldn't be dealing with the problem of ocean acidification that Sarah mentioned earlier. And one can go on down the list. What I find truly remarkable is that you have sort of this new breed of climate change contrarians or climate change deniers. I call them the sort of softer, gentler, the kinder, gentler sort of, it's the kinder, gentler form of climate change denialism, which is to say that, you accept the science, but you don't think it's that big of a problem. And by the way, the solution is taking part in some unprecedented, completely uncontrolled, massive planetary manipulation in the hope that maybe we'll get lucky and we will somehow offset global warming. But the chances are that we could end up even worse than we were to start with. I'm reminded of the song that I grew up with. I think many of the folks here probably remember the song as we were children learning the song, there was an old lady who swallowed a fly, right? Well, the fly isn't what killed her. It was the horse, of course. It was the geoengineering solution.
All right, let's go back to the list. There'll be a rendition of that later, the entire song. Are we already so far behind in addressing climate change? How do we offset the additional damage caused by government hostile towards science? So we have a government hostility towards science. Like, how do we catch up with the current political climate?
Well, aside from voting, I think there's this idea that there's some intrinsic threshold in the climate system that we need to avoid hitting, whether it's 1.5 degrees or 2 degrees or 4 degrees or whatever it is in different circles. These are not intrinsic physical thresholds that have any specific meaning. In other words, more global warming is probably worse than less global warming, but it's not totally clear that there's a catastrophically larger difference between 2 degrees and 2.2 degrees and 2.4 degrees. It's incrementally warmer and certain impacts get incrementally worse. And it's really clear that we want to avoid these 3, 4, 5 degree warming that we're currently on a trajectory to actually cause by the end of the 21st century. But the idea that you know, hope is lost and that we've already reached the point of no return, I don't think is an accurate framing, and that everything we do incrementally to reduce global warming is that much global warming averted and that many adverse impacts averted. And it's not necessarily that there's no very discrete finish line that if we fail to get to that point, then we've lost the race. It's really, as long as if we shoot for it and we get anywhere near that I think in the long run will be good news. And so that means that we have to start now, but it also means that the year-to-year variations in policy, to a certain extent, are less important than the endpoint that we get to.
Okay, I think this is going to be the final question before we wrap up, so let's take a look. Population control used to be high on the environmental agenda. It's now a hidden issue. How do we get it back on the table, given the ethnic, regional, and religious issues that complicate it and make it politically untouchable? This assumes that it is actually a solution, but it's in the solutions category. So, Sarah.
I'd love to take a stab at this one. So, China had a one-child policy, and now that's been softened. So if two people were only child, they can have two children if they so choose. This is not a society that we have yet voted for in this country, but I mean, we can always be surprised, I suppose. But there is a really easy and ethically unproblematic way to lower fertility rates, and that is to educate women. I have one child, and I have a PhD, and my son would love a sibling, but I haven't quite had time yet, okay? And so what happens as women achieve higher educational levels is that, you know, we all have free choice, or biology dictates in my case, but you can have different numbers of children, but on average, we can have a free choice, right? But on average, the more educated women are, the fewer children. So for that agenda, we can go in a nice direction with a somewhat unpalatable topic.
So we have one more question for you. And it's another word cloud. We asked you before we started, what's the one word that describes how you feel when you're talking to someone about climate change? We're going to optimistically ask you right now, what's the one word that describes how you now feel or will feel about talking to someone about climate change? We get paid a bonus for how big that confident, informed thing now. Now, come on. All right. I'm happy that frustrated is much smaller, even though another F word still appears. I'm happy not to see uninformed either. That's great. I want to say thank you to the museum and to the Institute of Environment and Sustainability at UCLA for partnering on creating this event this evening. I hope that all of you plan on have tickets for subsequent events. They're going to be wonderful. I know many of the speakers who are going to be with you for the evenings to come. I want to thank our panelists, Sarah Kuechner, Stanley Schneider, Michael Mann, for a wonderful job. And I want to thank you for your great questions and your participation and being game with us on the experiment tonight with the polling. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much. Have a good evening.